Hello and welcome to Health Bites. The Health Bites is brought to you by the Public Health Unit of the Ministry of Health and Social Development. I'm your host, the Public Health Communications Specialist, Natasha Latsom-Humphrey. Today on the program, we have some ladies from the Environmental Health Unit here to talk about mosquito awareness as part of Mosquito Awareness Week. We have with us our Deputy Chief Environmental Health Officer, Ms. Henrietta Alexander. Welcome to the program. And we want to welcome our Environmental Health Officer, Ms. Camille White. Welcome to the program. All right, Henrietta, mosquito awareness, this is nothing new. We always talking about vector control. We want to ensure that, you know, we have our key messages out there. We want to fight the bite.
Fight the bite.
So tell us a bit about the mission and objectives of Mosquito Awareness Week.
So the Caribbean Mosquito Awareness Week was created by the Caribbean Public Health Agency, by CARFA, and it was basically created to promote and educate the community, the public, on ways that we can control mosquitoes, control vectors. The key message or the key objective for Mosquito Awareness Week is to strengthen existing vector control initiatives and mobilize the public to eliminate mosquito breeding sites from public and private places. So the theme has always been fight the bite. And it's small bite, big threat, because we know that mosquitoes are very small, but they do pose a very big threat. So the Caribbean Mosquito Awareness Week, it's basically a chance for us to really push vector control, get our initiatives and control measures out there to the public, and to give them a boost to take more accountability and responsibility for their surrounding areas.
Wonderful. And we did see earlier in the week that you guys went out into the schools. I know that is one way that you promote the week. So tell us about those school visits and other ways that you intend to promote the week.
Okay, so for this week, we have been in schools. We've been in 3 schools so far. So we educate the children of what a mosquito is. Some of them thought that mosquitoes would sting, what mosquitoes actually bite. Mm-hmm. So it's not like a wasp. And that's how they spread disease. They were very interested in knowing that the mosquito actually expels saliva into humans. And that's how they spread disease from one person to another, because they have to numb your skin. Because one of the questions they asked was, why don't you feel them when they touch you? So they asked a lot of questions, good questions. So it was very motivating to see that they were so eager to learn about mosquitoes and so interested. We had a microscope, so they got to look at under the microscope, adult mosquitoes. So they were so amazed that, you know, there's all these features, the antennae, they learn about legs, markings on legs and stuff like that. So they will be able to identify when a mosquito bite them, what type of mosquito. They'll be able to identify what a larvae is, breeding sites, and to look around their house once a week and make sure that there's no water collecting containers around their homes.
Mm-hmm. Wonderful. And what 3 schools have you visited thus far?
We went to Alexandrina Maduro in Bagas Bay, Leonora Deville, and Willard Wheatley.
Nice. And yeah. How many more do you schedule?
We have two more for next week.
Wonderful. And you said that the children are being receptive and they're asking a lot of engaging questions. Tell me, why did you feel it was important to go into the schools this week?
One of the reasons why we always target children is because once they are interested and once they are engaged, they would usually bring back the information to their parents. I know when my son is in school, you know, he would say, "Mommy, teacher said this and teacher said that." So usually teacher is always right. So when you have persons visiting the schools and they learn that information, they usually take it back. So they can be the ones to have their parents on their P's and Q's. They retain the information more. And again, once they're interested, they're going to keep pressing and keep pushing to see some changes. And that's what we saw at the school. Camille also said that we did the hunt where they had to go around the premises to check to see if they had any breeding sites, and they found, we planted some sources, but they also found things that we did not plant. Mm-hmm. So they are aware and they are eager to learn and to do their part as well.
Definitely. And I saw some of the pictures and the excitement, you know, on their faces. And I think it's always important as well that we do target children, you know, because they definitely come home, because my set were the girls. They're younger. The boys, you know, they could care less, but the girls, they're still in, you know, primary school, and they're eager. And, you know, when they learn stuff, they do bring it home. And we do hope for our viewing audience, you know, that, you know, we listen out to the children. And if they want us to come out in the yard, you know, because we're trying to reduce mosquito breeding sites. Right. We're coming up on hurricane season.
Yes.
Now, so transitioning into this question, you know, what will the department be doing to prepare for the hurricane season? And what should we as, you know, householders and, you know, persons, business owners and premises, persons with premises and stuff be doing this in preparation for the hurricane season to ensure that, you know, we could fight the fight?
Okay. The division is not going to do anything differently. Our entomological surveillance is ongoing. We go out into the fields daily. We do ponds and guts every Friday weekly. So it's just for us to continue doing what we're doing and also encouraging the general public to do their part in terms of cleaning up their premises, unblocking drains. Anything that can cause stagnant water, you want to be proactive in dealing with that. And of course, cleaning your premises, because once you have debris and litter around the place, we know that mosquitoes can breed in those sources as well. And Camille, do you have anything else
yes.
to add?
We are doing a little bit things a little bit differently because now we have maps. We've been collecting adults, so we have hotspots that we visit more often. So, should I say the hotspots? Like,
Go ahead.
Road Town, Purcell Estate, and East End are the three major spots that we find high amount of mosquito. So, we like people in that area to be more focused and more vigilant about the tanks and buckets that they have in that area.
So those areas are high because of what? They have more garbage?
We found more Aedes aegypti mosquitoes in those areas.
But why?
Because of the breeding containers.
Okay. So we're encouraging persons in those areas, you know, to take extra special care, even if it's not your premises. Tell us some stuff about the Aedes mosquito itself in terms of, you know, its breeding cycle and its distance. Because sometimes, you know, I might be in my yard thinking, okay, my yard clear, but I'm like 50 feet from somebody else's yard who may not take that interest and still being affected. I'm like looking at in my person, like, where's these mosquitoes coming from? I'm not breeding any, you know, I don't have any sources. So talk to us a bit about the mosquito and their cycle and their range as to why persons should have a little bit more pride and feel a little bit more, you know, have a little collective attitude to help reducing this issue.
So the adult Aedes aegypti mosquito is able to fly for blood within 20 meters. So 20 meters to your left, 20 meters to your right. So you have to not only look at your premises, you have to look at your neighbor's premises too. So we are actually each other's keeper. Mm-hmm. The larvae, an Aedes aegypti adult is able to live up to 1 month, and they will feed every day. So if you think about it, and they lay 100 eggs, so if you think about a mosquito laying 100 eggs in 30 days, so you have about 3,000 eggs a month that could feed on you. So that's a picture that people need to have
so
in their head.
So they lay eggs every day?
Every day they would lay eggs. Once they bite you,
wow.
They rest, they rest, and they lay eggs. And, sorry, the male mosquito actually waits for the female. The males actually emerge first and wait for the females to emerge. And they impregnate them one time. And they don't need to they don't need to mate again for the next month. So they actually have eggs. They just need blood for the proteins to produce the eggs. So we have a big task. When you see one mosquito, it's not just one mosquito. Yeah. It's actually 100 others somewhere around in your house, right, somewhere in your yard. The larvae lives from 5 to 7 days. They don't bite. They're not harmful. So we're trying to target that area as our treatment. So you have to try to, because they don't spread disease at the larvae, pupa, and egg stage. And the pupa stage just lasts for 2 days. So we want, when you see pupa, you know that you probably have some adults already flying around, so you need to get rid of those larvae quickly because they're going to pupate soon and start to bite. Mm-hmm. So that's basically what we taught the children in school.
Wonderful. Now I need you to break down for me. I don't understand meters. Mm-hmm. So what does that translate into feet?
When you think of like the track, mm-hmm, right, you know the long straight is 100. So mm-hmm, just 20 meters. So it's not far. And of course, it also depends on the wind as well. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So that is why it's important that everyone has a part to play in, mm-hmm, vector control. Mm-hmm. And you do have to be your neighbor's keeper, as Camille said, because your house, you may not be breeding any mosquitoes, but the house two houses down mm-hmm, would be breeding, and it can also, the mosquitoes can also affect you.
Mm-hmm. So what are the key messages?
The key messages, fight the bite. You want to make sure that you protect yourself. You want to ensure that you clean around your premises. You turn over any container that can collect water that you're not using. If you're going out in the evening, you want to make sure that you wear long sleeve clothing to protect yourself. Use bed nets. Use mosquito screens. You can also use eco-friendly products like rosemary and lemongrass oil. Those also help to repel the mosquitoes. But the goal is to engage in source reduction. If you do not have an area or a place where the mosquito can lay the eggs, then you will not have as much adult mosquitoes. So the goal is to practice source reduction. We want to make sure that you clean around your premises, whether it's your home, your work, your church, wherever. You want to make sure that you do that so that we can prevent mosquito breeding.
Mm-hmm. Now, when we speak into the homeowners and, you know, persons, you know, residing in residential areas, I think it's a lot easier for them to, you know, take that pride in ensuring that their surroundings are clean and what's not. But what are we doing in the cases of, you said, churches, in the cases of businesses? How are you communicating with them to spread this message?
During our entomological surveillance, our weekly entomological surveillance, we still go to these places and we would speak to householders during our inspections and our assessments. Persons are also allowed or encouraged to call us if they see that they have a mosquito issue or, you know, whatever it is that we can give them advice on, whether it be broken septic tanks, because that is a source that we are finding a lot of breeding in. And we have been finding open wells. Mm-hmm. So those are some major sources of mosquito breeding. So we are also imploring persons that have wells and septic tanks, of course, on the property, that they need to check those as well. Make sure that it's properly sealed so that mosquitoes cannot fly in and breed.
Mm-hmm. And we're also going to start a fish program where we could put fish in like wells or cisterns, abandoned cisterns and things like that. Even in your tank and even in your cistern at home, you could put fish in. So we're doing that. Hopefully we'll start by next month.
So that's the guppies.
Guppies. Yes. So they eat the mosquito larvae.
Oh, cool. And yeah. Where would you get these fish?
We are going to do it.
Oh, so then you will contact.
Yeah, so you could call.
If persons are
interested, could call environmental health,
and then we can get them. We used to do it a couple of years ago, but after the hurricane with the damage of our shed, we stopped collecting the guppies. But that is something that we definitely trying to bring back on stream as an eco-friendly way to prevent mosquito breeding, or to at least abate or control some of the breeding that is already happening.
Definitely. And I know I can't let you go without talking about the fogging. You know, we love to talk about when environmental health come into fog. They don't see those mosquitoes killing people. Like, okay, what do you say to comments like that?
So we already had the discussion. fogging would only be done in dire situations where we see that based on our data that there is an increase in the mosquito population, the adult mosquito population. That is not something that we want to continuously do because the mosquitoes can build a resistance to the chemicals that we use, and then we would be in even greater trouble. So the message is source reduction and to keep your premises clean and let us deal with the mosquito on the larva stage rather than the adult stage.
Mm-hmm. Final thoughts, ladies.
When you see we actually fogging, that means the situation is dire. So you need to be extremely more vigilant when you see us fogging. Mm-hmm. So I would like people to know fogging is not the answer to controlling mosquitoes because we only kill the adults. The eggs and the larvae are still inside the water and not affected by the fog.
So it goes back to the source reduction. We have to deal with it at the source. So the final thoughts is that we all have a part to play in vector control, environmental health, the vector control unit. We will continue to do our assessments, and we would just like you to, the public, to work along with us. Our team is relatively small. We have about 10 people. So there are more of you than it is of us. But if we do all do our part, all play our part, including the children, as we see this week. Mm-hmm. Once we all play our part, then we can combat this mosquito issue that is, of course, an issue worldwide.
Well, wonderful. We love to thank our ladies from the Environmental Health Division for coming on the program today to educate us further on, you know, mosquito awareness and vector control. And like she said, we're encouraging you to fight the bite. It's your personal responsibility and our collective responsibility as a community to ensure, because you know the Aedes, they live with us and among us, and, you know, they're responsible for, you know, chikungunya, remember that, the Zika and dengue fever and what's not. And so it's a very dangerous little animals. So we want us all to do our part to reduce source reduction. Go out into your yards weekly, around your premises, businesses, and, you know, employ those children to help and you know, do the detective work every Saturday morning or whatever Saturday evening to help us to do source reduction. So reporting for the Ministry of Health and Social Development, I am Public Health Communication Specialist Natasha Latsam-Humphrey. Thank you for tuning in, and please reduce mosquito breeding sites.